Now on BBC One, Inside Out with Joe Crowley.
For me and friends of my age, mad cow disease seems like a distant nightmare, something that haunted us on the news as we grew up. Tonight's programme has made me think again, and sadly, given the disease a painful new relevance. It's about a young guy, like me, starting out on a career in the media when he was struck down by the human form of the disease. And it's a story about a mother's relentless search for answers. She tries to find out who killed her son.
Take your tongue out, go on.
Go on.
Go on, pull a face.
My name's Christine Lord. My 24-year-old son is upstairs in my bedroom dying of the human form of mad cow's disease. I'm extremely angry that this tragedy has happened to my fit, young, handsome son, and I want some answers, and I want to find out who was responsible for killing my son.
Go on, pull a face, Andy, put your tongue out, go on.
This is Christine's story. Her son Andrew has just been diagnosed with variant Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease, or VCJD, even though he hasn't eaten beef for years. Andrew has worked on national radio since he was 16.
It's February 2005, and I've already broken my New Year's resolution that I'd stop giving.
He was still working as a producer just 6 months ago.
But I'll tell you what, it's as crazy as a bag of old rag.
Now he can hardly talk.
It says to my number one son, Andrew, thank you for being you and for coming into my life. You will have a big part of my heart forever.
Christine didn't want us to film Andrew because she thought it might upset him, so we gave her a camera to film important events herself, like his 24th birthday. She also used the camera to record her own thoughts.
It's his birthday today, and last night we went out with his friends. We went to the fun fair, and I stood with Andrew while they got on the waltzers and they went on the roller coasters and all the other things that young people do. I wondered what was actually going through Andrew's head because, you know, all his friends were full of beans, jumping around, in and out, dancing around, and he was laughing with them. But there was a sense of bewilderment on his face a lot of the time, and we brought him home. And in the car, he started trembling. Immediately, I have a picture of the footage of the mad cows that was on TV throughout the 80s. And my son had his really wide eyes and his teeth were chattering. I knew it wasn't the cold.
To help find out how the disease is transmitted, scientists have asked Christine to fill in a questionnaire about the products Andrew might have used.
Contact lens fluid, HRT, homeopathic medicines, school dinners, baby formula, Farley's Rust, everything that you could possibly think is in here. I do lie awake at night and think, you know, perhaps if he hadn't had those immunisations, perhaps if he hadn't had school dinners, that he wouldn't be dying. I want some answers, and I'd like to talk to people that were involved in this, and I'd like to talk to people that allowed this to happen.
Christine's a freelance journalist, so she's used to researching stories. Now she wants to find some answers about what's happened to her son. She's come to Pitsom Farm near Midhurst, where the first case of mad cow disease was spotted in 1984. It's just 30 miles from her home in Southsea.
Hello, David.
Good morning,
I'm Christine.
Hi, Christine.
So this was the dairy where you found your first case?
Through the back there, there's a roofed shed, and that's a straw yard.
Yeah.
So these cattle were straw yard housed.
Yeah.
And when we were doing examination...
Vet David B was called out to treat that first cow. Seven other cows later died after displaying similar symptoms.
We did have a range of clinical signs. We had cows that were aggressive, cows that had lost weight, cows that had become incoordinate, so they couldn't walk normally. They would pick up a back leg awkwardly. Cows with head tremor. And we weren't seeing those anywhere else. So we actually called it Pitts and Farm syndrome. It was something that we were sure and convinced was specific to this place. We never dreamt it was going to be the terrible disease it's been in cattle, and even more so with people tragically like your son.
The symptoms that you described about lack of coordination, trembling, loss of weight, that's exactly what I've been experiencing with my son for 6 months.
This trip is the first time Christine has been more than a few miles from Andrew since he was diagnosed.
It's a journey I've had to make on his behalf, because he can't do it himself. And I have to be his voice in the wilderness, because it feels like we've been forgotten. And I think the broader public at large has forgotten about it. And everybody in the UK over 10 has been exposed to this.
I need to give you a hug.
Did you brush your teeth when you had a bath? Did you brush your teeth? You can't remember?
Okay. Andrew is gradually losing control of his body.
I'm really good. Do you want me to do it, Mum?
Do you want Aunt Emma to do it?
What's wrong?
What's wrong?
But Christine is still filming, because she wants the public to know what it's like. She gets the camera out whenever she has a moment to herself.
His arms are all bending and gallant in all peculiar shapes.
She's been advised to put Andrew in hospital.
Too many questions, no answers. Got my diary here.
But she's determined to care for him at home.
It's like a dam that's about to burst, and it may do it at the wrong time.
Because occasionally there are still glimpses of her son.
For about half an hour, it felt like I had most of my son back, because he talked quite coherently and quite sensitively. In fact, he said to me, "Mum, you're working too hard, this is too much." What a wonderful man my son is.
The cows from Pitson Farm had a brain disease, spongiform encephalopathy. It's common in sheep and is known as scrapie, but it had never been seen in cows before. Government scientists realised it might be dangerous. But a memo, written in 1986, suggested playing it low-key. This is the first time that Christine has read it.
If the disease turned out to be bovine scrapie, it would have severe repercussions to the export trade, and possibly also for humans. It is for these reasons I have classified this document confidential.
For the next 18 months, farmers were allowed to sell infected beef to the public.
The disease will have severe repercussions to the export trade, and possibly also for humans. I think the telling word is export trade. It's profit over people again.
The public wasn't told about bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or BSE, until almost a year after the memo was written.
Also tonight, the mystery disease that is killing cows in 14 counties.
Government experts soon realised that BSE had been caused by feeding animal protein to cattle. At the time, they believed it had come from scrapie in sheep, and as scrapie had never been a danger to humans, they concluded that BSE would not be dangerous either.
Everyone, children, adults, patients in hospital, can be quite confident that it's safe to eat beef.
I am totally and completely sure that there is no risk to man from eating beef, and that means meat is quite safe to be eaten by man, either in this country or any other country of the world.
In 1990, BSE jumped species when a cat was infected by pet food. Some scientists were now worried, but the government still insisted beef was safe. Agriculture Minister John Gummer was so convinced, he used his daughter Cordelia to reassure the public.
And it's like beef burger should be, without onions.
Can I have
and in a moment I shall put some ketchup on it. But Cordelia doesn't like ketchup very much, actually.
The government said it was acting on the best scientific advice, but one of the scientists on its advisory committee was also a paid consultant to the beef industry. When the government wanted some reassurances about the safety of beef, the industry actually drafted some suggested answers and sent them to its scientist on the committee.
We agree that we need succinct answers to the questions, and my colleagues in our PR company have drafted the sort of answers they would like to see.
Again, it's the first time that Christine has read this, and it's an emotional discovery.
When I'm reading this as a journalist, I'm also reading this as a parent of Andrew. The journalist in me is absolutely fired up. I need to find out more about this. But also the mum in me needs to find more about this. But also the mum in me is so upset because my son is dying because of this.
Andrew's condition is getting worse.
Can you hear me? A bit thirsty.
He's no longer aware of his surroundings, so Christine has agreed to let us film him.
Right, let's try and have a drink for Mummy.
I'm so exhausted, I am beyond healing.
A bit of swallow. Anything?
Huge sighs and massive gasps for air go through his body every couple of hours. He has a sheen of sweat over his face and oil constantly that we have to keep wiping away. And I'm not sure how much longer this will go on. This could go on for a long time.
Now, Mummy's going to put some drops under your tongue, OK? And that'll stop you having all that spit there, OK?
At times I feel like, you know when you get a chip in the windscreen of your car? And if you just touch it accidentally, the whole thing shatters. That's how I feel. That's how fragile I am.
You're in a deep sleep, aren't you? Aren't you? Hmm? Did you hear that? You like that, don't you? You like Mummy stroking you? Yeah. And we talk about all the things that you've done, all the happy times that we've had, the holidays, and how much you make me laugh and smile. Yeah? And what a handsome, talented young man you are. And we talk about things like that.
Christine's search for answers has brought her to London to see the man who is leading the search for a cure.
We've been able to stop the disease in its tracks and reverse it in laboratory mice by a particular procedure which hits the normal prime protein in the brain. It's
too late for Andrew, but Professor John Collins thinks a treatment for people may be just a few years away.
This research is going very well. We're making a lot of progress, but it's still going to be some years before we'll have a drug that achieves that. But we think it is achievable.
The number of VCJD cases has been falling.
This laboratory is our containment level 3 laboratory. It's a special laboratory where human and bovine prions, BSE prions...
But there's still a desperate need for a cure, as researchers fear there could be a second wave of cases.
You can see it's one of the largest facilities of its type in Europe. This may be the first wave in people who are unusually genetically susceptible. and that others in the population who are less susceptible and have longer incubation periods may still be infected, but they won't show signs of the disease for many years.
Could there be thousands out there incubating the disease then?
There could certainly be thousands. We have to consider that maybe 1 in 1,000 of the population might be silently carrying the infection. That's entirely possible.
This is also the hospital where Andrew was first diagnosed.
The last time I was here, he was upstairs having a tonsil biopsy, and I came down here to the chapel and looked at the request for prayer. And there's a lot of sick people in this hospital. A lot of people still have hope. And I read the ones before and it said, you know, God bless Dad, let him get better from his stroke, let my little baby become well again. And I knew that there was just absolutely no hope for my son. So actually I wrote a prayer, please let my Andrew be at peace. And as his mother, I prayed that he actually didn't come round from the anaesthetic, because I knew what was ahead of him and I didn't want him to go through that. So while everybody else was down here with prayers of hope, prayers of like, Dad get better, Mum get better, I was actually praying for my son to die.
By the mid-90s, several scientists were concerned about the risks to human health, but it wasn't easy to speak out.
Were scientists and experts leaned on?
In the early 90s and mid-90s, yeah, I certainly was.
Like what?
Well, I had phone calls from government departments, you know, somewhat intimidating terms. I wouldn't describe them as threats, but they'd left you in no doubt that you weren't making yourself very popular by saying these things.
The government thought beef was safe because it had banned the sale of the infectious parts of the cow. The brains, offal and spinal cords were supposed to be removed, but some ended up in a product called MRM, mechanically recovered meat, which was used in hospitals and schools. Sir Andrew could have caught VCJD from school dinners.
You know, very large numbers of people are at school and they're there for years. So the actual exposure to school dinners and the potential exposure to MRM was potentially large. I'm only speculating here, but that would sort of make sense.
As Andrew's mother, I feel very angry that I didn't have an informed choice. If actually I'd seen the memos that I've seen now in 1980, which were in 1985, go right back to 1985, I would have chosen for him not to have school meals. And he may very well be here now.
Christine believes the answers might lie back at his old schools. She's been talking to former dinner ladies who have told her that before it was decided to remove the brain and spinal cord, the government encouraged them to use offal because it was so cheap.
They minced it all up and disguised it and hid it in the pies, the sausages, the burgers, so that children would eat it. And of course that was the most highly infectious part of the animal during the BSE crisis.
Later in the 80s, schools stopped using offal, but many switched to MRM, the mechanically recovered meat that may still have contained infectious material.
I keep seeing my son, 5, 6, 7, 8, right up until he was about 11, 12, but especially little, holding his dinner money and going into school and saying, Mum, I got my dinner money. And I gave him the money that killed him. And that's a terrible thing that I'm having to carry. This is breaking my heart. And I didn't think it could break anymore, to be honest. My house drips sadness now. It's just everywhere. As much as I try to be optimistic and full of fun, which is basically my personality, and I try to be very buoyant around Andrew, in Andrew's bedroom there's a row of his clothes now. And I know that he will never wear outdoor clothes again. He's in pyjamas now all the time now. He will never walk outside this house again.
The next time he goes outside this house, will be in his coffin.
Andrew's now been put on a morphine pump.
All his medication now goes through here and then through the muscle. And also he's on fluids as well to keep him hydrated. So this driver is now in a really pretty bag that I bought several summers ago. And it's like, who would have thought, you know, when I bought that bag, that this was what it would be used for. And the reason why it's used for that is so it's a bit unobtrusive really for my daughter and for people coming into the room. Outside there, the world is moving on and moving forward, and to a certain extent it feels like time in a way is suspended here a bit, but at the same time it's sort of running through my fingers like quicksand really.
I've stayed with Andrew constantly since the weekend. It's Thursday today, and I think I've probably had about 5 hours sleep in those days.
Andrew.
It was just a case of laying there in the silence with him, really, and holding his hand, and telling him that it's okay to let go. It's 8:20 and as you can hear, the alarm's gone off again. It's gone off every 35 minutes since midnight. The noise that he was making was like a car backfiring, but worse, 1,000 times worse than that. Andrew's breathing now is every 30 seconds, and then he stops, and then he starts again. I've been told eventually he won't start again. So I'm laying next to him wondering, is this the last breath my son will ever take? Sunday, 16th of December. Sunday, the 16th of December, at 9:25, Andrew died. 24 years of age.
With permission, Madam Speaker, I would like to make a statement about the latest advice which the government has received from the Spongiform Encephalopathy Advisory Committee.
In 1996, the government announced that BSE had jumped to humans.
The unit has identified a previously unrecognised and consistent disease pattern.
It was 12 years after the first case at Pitson Farm, 10 years after scientists first discovered the possible risks in that confidential memo, and 6 years after Agriculture Minister John Gummer assured the public that beef was safe to eat. Lord Phillips' inquiry into BSE concluded that the government's campaign of reassurance was a mistake. He suggested that involving Cordelia was the wrong option, but he didn't criticise Mr Gummer's handling of the crisis. It's now been 4 months since Andrew's death, and Christine is on her way to see Mr Gummer. She thinks he could have done more.
We're about 2 minutes from John Gummer's office. We've just passed the Houses of Parliament, and it's because the government and the establishment didn't put precautions in place, the appropriate precautions in place, that I'm now actually having to confront Mr Gummer about my son's death. There's a lot of emotions going through here at the moment. I'm shaking like a leaf. I'm really scared that I'm actually going to let Andrew down and become angry, and I don't want to become angry. I want to be measured, and I want to actually put him on the spot.
When you said beef was safe, why did you say beef was safe when it clearly wasn't?
Because I believed it was. I was prepared to eat it myself. I was prepared for my family to eat it because I believed it to be safe and because all the evidence showed that it was.
I have spoken to several scientists. There was selective research. They were sat on.
No scientist of any kind was stopped by me from either giving their information or, in many cases, being cross-examined by me. I only wanted to know the facts. Look, how could I possibly have allowed my family and myself to eat something that I thought wasn't safe?
I have actually got recommendations from the Phillips report. It is now clear that this campaign of reassurance was a mistake.
Well, I can only quote Lord Phillips, who specifically said to me in the report, in his statement about the report, that he had no criticism of me.
You're Minister of Math. What about ministerial responsibility?
That's what Lord Phillips was saying about my ministerial responsibility. He had no criticism of me.
How can I accept that when Lord Phillips says the possibility of risk to humans was not communicated to the public?
I do not believe I could or should have done other than I did do. And I also believe that that is exactly the answer which the independent inquiry came to. So it's not only my belief, but it's the belief of the independent inquiry. And it's also my memory, because I remember that at every point and on every occasion, I sought to make the best choice, the best decision I could for the safety and health of myself, my family, my country.
This is not a disease without blame. This is not a disease that just happened, but it's the British establishment against me, and I don't know whether I'm able to even make a dent in it, but I'm going to try on Andrew's behalf. He asked me to do this. When he was dying, he said to me, "Mum, this must never happen again. Mum, you must find out who did this to me, and Mum, you must expose them."
Scientists estimate that 1 in 1,000 people in Britain could be carrying the infection, but they still don't know how many will go on to develop VCJD. Christine has published all her research on a website. She's determined to keep searching for answers, and she wants to hear from anybody who might be able to help her find the truth.
I will persist with my investigations, and I will continue my research, and every day, every week that I come up with some more stuff, it will go on the website, and I will pursue these men and women that I consider responsible. So this is not the end, it is the beginning, until I have justice for Andrew and all the other Andrews that are to come.
And if you'd like to know more about Christine's story, then the details are on our website at bbc.co.uk/insideout. Well, I'm afraid that's it for this series, but we'll be back in the autumn. So if you've got a story you'd like me to investigate, then please do get in touch. And if you're not on the internet, you can write to me at BBC Inside Out, Havelock Road, Southampton, SO14 7PU.